Good morning and welcome to the 38th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Agenda item 2 is the fourth oral evidence session as part of the committee's inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas. Today we will be hearing from a panel of representatives of the healthcare workforce. And for this morning's session, I welcome Don McDonald, NHS Highland Branch Secretary Unison, Jackie Lambert, Director of the Royal College of Midwives Scotland, Nicola Gordon, Policy Manager of the Royal College of Nursing Scotland, who both join us online, and Michael Dixon, Chief Executive of the Scottish Ambulance Service. And we'll move straight to questions, and Ivan McKee.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, panel, those here and those online. I'd like to focus on the proposed National Centre and to get your sense of how you see that contributing to addressing the challenges that we face in remote and rural healthcare. And maybe just start by opening up by asking what you think the priority should be for the National Centre over its first few years, and I don't know if there's anyone's willing to jump in and give a perspective on that. Get us warmed up. Don, when you go.
Sorry.
Yeah.
You want to? So my perspective is certainly that in the remote and rural areas, we struggle because we have a lack of affordable housing. So I cover the whole of NHS Highland and Argyll and Bute, which is a landmass of Belgium. So when people come to these areas, I don't think at first they understand the rurality in these areas. And therefore, they come back to us saying that they can't afford to pay the rents that are being charged. And you can understand in areas like Isla and 36 islands within NHS Highland, you know, we don't have a lot of housing. So they can charge what they like. So people can't afford on the pay that NHS staff are being paid these housing. So what we definitely need to encourage people to come to Highland, and I'm not just talking nursing, I'm talking about AHP staff, doctors, junior doctors, whatever, is we need affordable housing for staff to be able to come there and bring their families to these areas.
So what you're saying, I think, is if unless the National Centre and other work addresses that issue, the other work it's doing is going to be of limited value.
I think that the bottom line is, if you don't have the resources and the resources of the staff, where do you go from there?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Michael, I don't know if you get any thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think that the first thing is it's not a numbers game. It's really easy to focus on just, you know, the number of staff we would need, but actually in small teams that you find in rural locations, the difference between one and two people can be absolutely vast in terms of sustainable services. And of course, if you lose a couple of people, then it can destabilise the whole team. More people are likely to say, well, actually, this isn't right for me. I think, for me, the focus has to be about putting remote and rural as a badge of honour, front and centre in terms of what the work of health and social care looks like moving forward. It's a huge privilege to work in these communities. It's a massive opportunity to see a breadth of activity that you simply wouldn't get to see if you're working in a city centre location, if you're working in the central belt, and harnessing that. And we've seen some really good work in NHS Shetland. We've worked with a former role, Chief Executive of NHS Shetland, the Discover the Joy GP project, which was about allowing people to strike a different balance in their work life. After the pandemic, we're all not just chained to our desks 9 to 5. People want to do different and exciting things, be that within the rest of Scotland, within the rest of the UK, or even globally. So offering really flexible opportunities for people to explore new and exciting career opportunities that they may not have considered before. So for me, the focus has to be about what the offer is for people who are considering remote and rural.
OK, now that's very helpful, and I suppose you said turning that into more of a positive in terms of the opportunities that are there, rather than who often portray it as a negative. The panel members online, I don't know if you want to contribute any thoughts on that. Jackie or Nicola?
Jackie's asked to come in.
Jackie. Oh, can't hear you.
Right, hopefully
got it now. That's us.
So, following on, I think there's something about currently there's remote and rural across Scotland, but it's often at the side of other health boards, so it doesn't get priority, it doesn't get seen, and the same metrics are often applied to remote and rural as they are applied to the central belt. When there needs to be the ability to look at remote and rural services in the round and look at it in the ability to provide a service not related to caseload size, for example, or population size, or be disadvantaged because, as we know across Scotland, there are a lot of remote and rural areas. You've got the prediction in terms of the reduced population size. That doesn't mean you don't still require a service. So there's that making sure that in that remote and rural there is what is required to provide the right service for families in those areas, not what is the caseload size, so we'll reduce the NRAC allowance, so we'll reduce the ability to provide that care. In terms of Don's point about housing, I know that, for example, in Skye, there was two midwives really happy to take jobs there, wanted to work in Skye, couldn't get accommodation, so couldn't work on Skye. So housing and accommodation is a huge issue, not just for workforce coming into the area, but also for students being able to afford to take up placements in remote and rural, which has a great impact on the ability to recruit. I've been a midwife working full-time in Argyll and Bute for 20 years, and the ability to bring students in and to show the amazing roles that can be undertaken in remote and rural. And often you hear this idea that being in remote and rural is a de-skilled workforce, or you risk being de-skilled. As the last gentleman said, we need to turn that around, that actually the skills in remote and rural are often much more broad, but also working to what would be an advanced level if there was an advanced level of practice recognition in maternity care. So I talked yesterday to midwives in the Western Isles and in Orkney who undertake roles that are not undertaken on the mainland to be able to provide the right care. So there's something about a recognition of roles, of enhancing the voice around remote and rural as a, rather than just something that's seen on the edge of other health boards, is really key. But also looking at services in terms of what is required for a service, not what is required in terms of caseload numbers.
Okay, thanks very much. And Nicola, have you got any thoughts?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you very much. I'll just comment very briefly. I agree with everything Dawn and Michael and Jackie have already said. I think there's something about understanding what the remit of the centre will be, because what you're hearing is this is a really, it's a wider issue that goes well beyond health and social care provision. It's about housing, transport, you know, the complexity of access to services in very remote and massive geographical areas. I think there's also something about understanding that caring for people in remote and rural communities is challenging. There's also needs to be recognition that care in the community is quite prevalent in remote and rural areas, and we have quite an older population there with increasingly complex needs. So there's something about understanding where the investment needs to be. I would also like to ensure that the work of the new centre links with all the other work that's already going on within Scottish Government. There are a number of centres and initiatives around workforce and addressing workforce challenges. I think it'll also be important that it links with the Ministerial Task Force on nursing and midwifery. So just those connections that are in place, and we don't end up with a number of disparate programmes that aren't well connected. Thanks.
Okay, that's great. Thanks. The next area I wanted to focus on, following up from that, was around about the scope and the potential for driving innovation, either in terms of innovative solutions and also extending to innovative ways of organising and delivering service, and the role that the centre could or should have in that area. So, Michael, you're nodding away there, so I'll let you come in first.
I actually think if you want to see innovation in practice, you go to a remote and rural location, because communities, and it isn't just the professionals, but communities come together and face huge challenges and overcome them. They come overcome them together within their own communities. It makes it, and it is, I said it before, it's such a privilege to work in that environment, such a privilege to live in that space, which is why other issues such as housing, transport are so critical. I think the fact is there is a wealth of innovation taking place. Where we often struggle is sharing that. We can take quite a protectionist approach to practice that occurs, and you know, we're all very, very different. Well, actually, we're all facing very similar challenges. So we need to put that aside and actually say, where there is innovation, let's look and see how we can spread that innovation across the piece. And I think the next piece, which is about the multi-professional approach to this, with the patient at the very centre of how we work. Fundamentally, traditional roles are rapidly changing. I'm a nurse by profession, and if you think of the innovation that's taking place within nursing right now, it's light years ahead from when I trained. You know, ambulance sector, you know, we have a really fortunate opportunity where we can extend our skills even further than we are currently and work in a whole range of sectors from primary care through to urgent and emergency care. So outside the normal confines of an ambulance service, that's all innovation, and it's all about shifting, you working with third sector, working with community organisations. But the challenge is for us as healthcare professionals is we have to let go some of the traditional models that we've really got used to over many, many years. And embrace that and say, yeah, we will have to share some risk with the patient, and that's okay. But I think that opportunity to share learning, that opportunity to think about completely different ways of working, I think is a really important opportunity that this approach presents.
Okay. So the centre needs to see that as one of its core missions, if you like, to work in that space.
I think not just a centre. I think for this to be really effective, the whole of the NHS in Scotland needs to embrace that innovation, because there's often a view, and it was mentioned a few moments ago, central belt models are just, you know, unless the innovation has come from the central belt, then it's not going to be applicable. But actually, what you find is in places like, I'll reference Shetland again, rapid adoption of innovative models that can then be scaled back up to be demonstrated across the whole of Scotland. So rather than the other way around, you don't need big scale models to deliver real rapid change.
Thank you. Anyone else want to come in on that innovation point? Sorry, Dawn, did you want to?
Oh, just thinking about the structures that we have in. We don't have the benefits of big urban hospitals. Mm-hmm. So a lot of, I'm a nurse in the background, so a lot of our nurses have taken on which has been classed as generalised skills, but it's not. They're really good skills and they're complex skills. So myself, I worked in A&E in Inverclyde, then I moved to Bute, worked in A&E, worked in the ward, and lastly 10 years I worked out in the community. And the amount of skills that we have, because we do not have those wraparound services, we stand alone. Mm-hmm. And you know, and I come from the Isle of Bute, you know, the A&E nurses are in there on their tod until a GP comes in. And they have to look after that patient on their own. And, you know, so they have to have this, those skills. The problem is it's seen as generalised skills, and that's wrong. Mm-hmm. And the biggest issue I hear back from members is we have all these skills, we utilise all these skills. And I worked in Inverclyde, I pressed a bleep, and somebody would come down and do an ECG. I pressed another bleep, somebody takes blood. We do all that. But it's not recognised through pay. And that's the skills that we need out in these rural areas, is that these nurses, are, and they are working to those levels, but they're not being recognised for it. So they leave because it's easier to go and work in an urban hospital where you get those wraparound services and you're getting the banding, and yet you're not doing half the specialised work that you're doing out in the rural areas.
OK, that's good. Thank you very much. I don't know if Jackie or Nicola want to come in on either of those. Jackie?
We can't hear you, Jackie.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, all good, yeah.
Sorry, there seems to be a delay in the unmuting. I think in terms of innovation, as Michael says, remote and rural are very good at innovating, but where some of the challenges are and have been are the links to the central belt. For example, Near Me was introduced in remote and rural way before it was being introduced anywhere else. We were able to provide consultant appointments in the women's home, sitting beside the woman, way before it was being done in the central belt and way before COVID. The challenge has often been getting the engagement from the central belt to be the other side of those links. And that's also when scanning services have to be developed in remote and rural, because people do not want to travel to the central belt or are not able to travel. And the most vulnerable families are the ones least able to travel. So they are the ones that are often denied access to care. So services are developed, but getting access to the training or the practice placements in the central belt to develop some of the skills required can often be a challenge. So there's no lack of innovation, but there's often lack of access to what's required to make sure that these services can be developed and sustained. There's also the other issue around, I know that in many of the community maternity units across Scotland, what I hear when I go round them all is no Wi-Fi accessible in the maternity unit, even though there's electronic records. Lack of the basic infrastructure to enable things, that innovation to be available. The other innovation is how education is provided. This idea that you still have to go to Aberdeen, Edinburgh or Glasgow to be educated is a dated model. We know that the ability is there to provide education so you can earn and learn where you live, because you're much more likely to stay in an area if you don't go away to train. And model that so that we maintain standards require the right infrastructure and require recognition of the need for educators and academics to develop and live in remote and rural areas. So it's not just about the ability to earn as you learn, it's the ability to provide that those career structures for people so that they remain in remote and rural areas. So there's no lack of innovation, there's often a lack of investment and in that ability to take things forward.
Great, thank you very much. Nicola, did you want to come in?
Yeah, thanks. Can you hear me okay?
Yes. Yeah.
I just briefly comment on that and pick up and say, so we're looking at innovation both in terms of technology and technological advances, but also innovative clinical practice and patient care. And I think the intersection of these is really important. Also, agree with the points that Jackie just made there around education, training, career development, and looking at new models or different things. We know we've got an issue around retention with the workforce. So what do we do once we attract people? Post-qualification, we're looking at nursing and midwifery. Where do they go? Remote and rural areas have some particular challenges around progression opportunities. So there's a number of things that can be looked at there through the task force. I think as well, we know that harnessing the power of technology, we've really seen that through COVID and in remote and rural areas, that's made a massive difference to patient care, and there's always more that can be done. I think there are particular issues there around funding, and that's understandable. So I think that needs to be looked at through the centre, but also training and backfill. So ensuring that staff feel competent and capable with the technologies that they're using. And I think there's something there about the balance of care. So how do we educate our communities so that they also feel confident in the care that they are receiving remotely, whether it's, digital first appointments and so on, but how does that fit the needs of what people expect from services? I also think we need to remember we need to look beyond the NHS. We're talking about the independent health and social care sector as well, and that's increasingly important because of the complexity of needs for those who are receiving social care. So I'd like to make sure that we capture that within the mix. Thanks.
Great. Thanks very much. A lot of doors open there that other members of the committee, I'm sure, will want to investigate further. Thank you.
Thank you. Ruth McGoy.
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick supplementary on some of what Ivan McKee was asking there. Michael Dixon, you mentioned Shetland twice and innovation. What is it about Shetland that's enabled them to innovate in the way that you've described?
It predates, it certainly predates my role as chief executive. A number of years ago, the various leaders of the community got together and said, and this is something that's existed in Shetland for a long time, and I apologise for the politicians in the room. Politics will always change, but we have to do the right thing for the people of Shetland. And that kicking boundaries down, it doesn't make any difference who employs you. It doesn't make any difference what badge you were. You were part of the community. And that drives everything that operates and works in Shetland. It drove our approach to COVID.
Check with you. Is there one health board and one health and social care partnership?
One health board, one health and social care partnership, and okay. One local authority. But okay. It's... And people have said, well, it must be easy then. We have exactly the same challenges. I'm no longer in Shetland, I hasten to add. There's a fantastic team there. The team that's there is face the same challenges in terms of housing and recruitment. But it's about putting the people in the community at the forefront of the decision-making processes. And it is in stark contrast to other remote and rural locations. So Outskerries, furthest away islands, very small community. We tried to recruit a nurse on a number of occasions and failed each and every time. And there was a range of reasons for that. As a nurse, you would go there and you have a tiny population. It ranges between 6 and 50, depending on the weather and the month of the year. So how do we sustain someone's skills during that time? How do we get that to be an effective, attractive role? So we engaged with the community and said, what's your biggest concern? How can this work best for you? And the biggest concern was actually what happens in the event of an emergency? Who do they speak to? Because Skerries has a particular profile. It has no runway that can be used for flights, so it means a helicopter transfer. And so what we discussed was actually having a healthcare assistant based there. And the idea of presenting this as a... You see the adverts, you know, come and live on a tropical island, you know, you and your partner and run it. And that kind of principle that you're making a difference to a community. It's been massively successful and the community really embraced that person. And again, it's just looking at things from a different angle, stepping away from traditional. But fundamentally, the first question you ask is, what do we need to do to protect our community? What do we need to do to sustain? And the close working relationship, which doesn't require organisational change, it's fundamentally about doing the right thing for Shetland, wherever you're employed by the council, by third sector, by the NHS, and it's pivotal.
Okay. Thank you, that's helpful.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Good morning to you all. So pick up also on the issue of innovation, but also link it to advocacy for communities, and so it's the staff as well as the people who are receiving the care. Is there a role for the new National Centre to advocate for the people in the communities? One of the submissions was from Dr. Gordon Baird on behalf of Caithness Health Action Team, Save Our Services, Isle of Skye and Galloway Community Hospital Action Group. And Gordon wrote, Dr. Baird wrote in this, that he's hoping to work with the new centre to provide information and understanding of national and regional issues and prevent ineffective repetition through feedback on effectiveness of local solutions. Throughout his submission, I'm thinking the word advocacy is a part of that. Is that something that you would support the National Centre as being part of the work?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, that's what we need, is that we need that voice there and that support to come out into the community. Because in the remote and rural areas, just as Michael said, and others have said, it's not just about the hospital settings, but it's also about what's out in the community. And we need people in there to be able to have that voice to help us move forward with what we need in these areas.
And I forgot to remind the panel that I was a clinical educator in a remote and rural area, delivering what you're talking about, ECG, blood draw, and things like that. So it was part of my job, so I forgot to remind colleagues and panel about that. Thanks.
Thank you. Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, convener. And just a question of interest as a practicing NHS GP. So I've heard with quite a lot of clarity about what has been said, especially what Nicola Gordon, when you spoke about the remit and what the remit of the National Centre is. So, as is in the National Centre, and to understand, does the panel feel that the National Centre remit will significantly address the key issues facing our workforce recruitment and retention in rural areas as it is set out right now.
Michael, do you want to answer?
I think there is a risk, and actually it goes back to Ms. Harper's question a moment ago. There's a risk that we see this as the solution for everything. You know, oh, it'll fix that. It needs to be an advocate for that. It needs to pick up this. We've got to recognise that there are many organisations involved in this that don't just have the limits at the NHS. It's also social care. It's also the links into local authority and to housing. It's also the challenge of, I've mentioned this previously, if you wish to come and work at the NHS in Scotland, you would need to apply 22 times to be able to work in every single board. That's an opportunity that we could easily overcome if we had a single way to be able to join the NHS in Scotland. So the risk is it becomes the solution, and then to reflect on the comments that were made about the from Kate Ness, that it becomes yet another duplication because it's trying to do absolutely everything. I would advocate it has to be very focused on what its aims and its opportunities that it can embrace are, rather than try and be the broadest possible thing. And actually, then we'll see the delivery that's able to do would be relatively limited. I think it's about fundamentally, and to tack back to Shetland, it is about taking a clear role, but knowing that it has a critical relationship with other key partners that work across the system and not trying to do everything.
I believe Jackie wants to come in on this too.
Hopefully you can hear me there. Yes, I think the remit is not 100% clear at the moment, but I suppose it's about having that ability to look at what's important. There is a real risk that it becomes, oh, well, that'll be for that centre to sort, rather than ensuring and amplifying the fact that remote and rural needs to be considered within all areas that are being looked at. For example, it's being highlighted very clearly within the task force, as Nicola mentioned earlier. But there is something about having that ability to promote the fact that that anchor institution idea about having NHS and care facilities in remote and rural. And it's not, and while there's innovation around substitution, there's also a risk that actually we should be promoting skills and high level of care to be provided, not just the expectation if you live in remote and rural, you will make do with a lesser health service. If we want anchor institutions, we need to actually look at, they have an impact on the population health. They have an impact on, because you have a workforce that live and work there. I live in, I'm sitting 10 miles from the nearest shop where I live, where I've joined in. And the things that make people come back and live in Argyll and Bute are the fact that there are jobs, there are opportunities. You can be born here, you can live here, you can go to school here. If we keep reducing what is available, then we will not have services, and the population prediction will be a self-fulfilling prophecy. So I think the centre needs to be the advocate for in all spaces.
Oh, we've lost you. Muted. I think you're muted again.
Yeah, so it needs to be the place that amplifies rather than the place that becomes a dumping ground for anything to do with remote and rural.
And Nicola, you wanted to come in too.
Thank you. Thanks. I absolutely agree with what Michael and Jackie have said. I think the problems are quite complex and long-standing, and they'll need some careful consideration of precisely which problems the centre is trying to solve. I think there is a risk that they could convey an impression the centre is the route to solve all the workforce and other challenges, but that it's a bit bigger than that, so we need to narrow that down. And I agree with Jackie, it would be helpful to better understand exactly what the remit of the centre will be. I think it was Dawn who mentioned at the start of the session that key to all of this is workforce. So we need a motivated, highly skilled, fairly paid workforce within remote and rural communities who've got access to good permanent housing, who are confident that they've got sustainable transport, good schooling options, childcare options, and so on. So it is really complex and wide ranging, and potentially there's a risk, as Jackie has said, that the centre could be seen as a little bit of a catch-all or a dumping ground to solve all the issues. So we need to be really careful it's not set up to fail. Thanks.
Thank you. So I think it's quite clear from what the panel have said that we should be finding out from the minister what exactly the remit is, and then we can certainly be asking if that's appropriate to you and further panelists. One of the things that I heard being said by Michael was that it should be a badge of honour working in remote and rural areas, and whilst I commend everyone who chooses to work in the NHS and especially going out to rural areas, that's surely not enough. Do we not need to incentivise people to go out and work in remote and rural areas and really try and grab people from other areas coming into Scotland or even those in Central Belt to relocate so that we actually increase the people who are coming, rather than try and move people that are already in the area? So my question is that incentivisation.
Michael, and then Dawn.
I think there is a mixed model. If you look at comparable roles across the world, the Australian Flying Doctor Service is an example where it's not incentivised in that way. People choose to work because it broadens their skill set, it gives them an opportunity. But it also means they can take that skill set back when they finish their time there, back into the city centre location. So it isn't just about financial incentives. It's also about broadening your range, your remit, your skill base, and then taking that back to your core role. Again, it's a challenge to do that within Scotland. Working across different organisations can be difficult. And again, that's something that could be made far easier just by the way we take people on, the way we recruit people. But also there's got to be the right people. You've really got to want to work in these communities. You've got to want to work in a rural location. We certainly find that when people do go and work in a remote setting, be that in an island or in one of the highland areas, that it is either for them quite quickly or it's not. And, there is, it's not unreasonable for people and as my own experience, arriving into Shetland in January and then going, wow, OK, it's really dark all of the time. And it's not something you'd necessarily considered. You'd not factored in the fact that it's incredibly expensive to heat your house if you're living in Shetland, because it's all electric. And we're all aware of the ongoing challenges about the cost of energy. You may not have thought those things through. And whilst it is beautiful, it isn't for everyone. And I think we've got to be pragmatic. That's why I think it's saying it as an opportunity. You can go over there, you can experience it. That's why the GP Joy project is so interesting and gives people the chance to taste what it's like living in these communities and then say, actually, yeah, I've really enjoyed this. I'd actually consider a permanent role. I hope you managed to get up to Shetland to do a shift, because that was the last time we spoke. It was something you were looking to.
And Dawn, if you want to come in here.
Yeah, I think certainly from my perspective, we need to get back to basics. If we want to incentivise people to come to these areas, firstly, we need to have that housing there to provide it for these people. Secondly, we need to look at the pay structures that are in place. If we want to incentivise people to come and stay, just as my colleague Michael has said there, we don't have competition like you have in Edinburgh and Glasgow. We have, small rural areas where things are more expensive to buy. We also need to look at progression. When you come up to the rural areas, when you're working in small islands, you can't progress from a band 5 to a band 6 and a band 7 as you can in the urban areas in Inverclyde and Glasgow and Edinburgh. You may stay at a band 5 for the whole of your career, and that doesn't help people, because they get to a point where they get fed up and they want to move away to get a better pay and move up that banding. So I think looking at the band 5 to band 6 is certainly something that we need to be looking at, because a lot of my members are on band 5s and have been for 20-odd years. And I think it's the services. If we want people to come and stay in these rural areas, we've got to have that service correct. We've got to be able to wrap around these people. Mental health is a massive issue within Argyll and Bute. The services are barely non-existent. We're struggling constantly with mental health. So it's having access to proper services. If you're bringing your family there, you want to make sure that you get access to services when you need them. That could be, you know, for children, paediatricians, things like that. And we really struggle to recruit and retain these services within NHS Highland. And I believe that one of the reasons for that is we are the only model in the whole of Scotland that has a lead agency in NHS Highland and a body corporate IGIB in Argyll and Bute. And that in itself brings its own complexities to people joining NHS Highland. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to our next segment and Ruth Maguire, but can I ask the witnesses, that we've got a lot of ground to cover, if you can be concise with your answers, please, that would be really helpful. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I'd like to ask about multidisciplinary teams. And if I come to Don McDonald first and then perhaps Jackie, the first question's about how teams are, the role of multidisciplinary teams will be different in remote, rural and island communities. And I suppose specifically coming to Dawn, if you look at Highland as an area, Argyll and Bute, you were talking about the Isle of Bute, that's closer to me in Ayrshire than it is to Inverness, where your health board is, and there'll be different needs within there. Can you speak about the different teams and give us a flavour of that, maybe?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've got a lot of teams that cover the whole of Argyll and Bute and NHS Highland. I think COVID was a terrible thing to happen, but what it did was it opened our eyes to teams. So now we have those meetings where people can get access through digital to be able to have that multidisciplinary meetings around the table that we never, you know, that before we struggled to get because of diaries and whatever else and people having to travel. Because as you say, Ruth, it's a massive area. So Teams has been absolutely fantastic for that. And also getting access near me, as Jackie was talking about. So I think digital works for us around the multidisciplinary way of working. And we need that because of our geographical layout.
And are, just to follow up on that, are there challenges? I mean, that sort of alluded a little bit when Michael Dixon was speaking about Shetland, that if you have a more compact area with your health board and your local authority and your health and social care partnership, although I appreciate the space between the islands, but then if we look at Highland, there's more challenge there perhaps in getting the services. I mean, you spoke about the NHS Highland being in Inverness, are we up there? And then the IGBs in Argyll and Bute. Yeah. Are there challenges around innovating between and recruiting in that way?
There is, there absolutely is. So NHS Highland is the employer for all NHS workers. But in Argyll and Bute, you've got the IGIB. So although we've got NHS workers that are part of that health and social care partnership, there's a bit of a complexity around that, Ruth, and the fact that the health care partnership, the IGIB, makes decisions. But actually, we've got employees that work for NHS Highland. And people get really confused about what, where and when around policies. And then what do they cover? So it's a massive area to cover, and I think we need to be specific when we're bringing people to these areas and what the jobs can look like, because we could have somebody in Fort William having to cover Argyll and Bute.
Just finally on that, we speak a little bit about urban policies being implemented in remote, rural and island communities, but would you say that the challenge is actually almost within that whole thing? It's not necessarily policies from Glasgow or Edinburgh, it can sometimes be policies from Inverness or Fort William being tried to be applied in?
Absolutely.
Okay,
absolutely.
Thank you. Jackie Lambert had also mentioned the issue of the remote and island areas being far removed from the health board. Do you want to say a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think, as you know, that we have the IGBs across Scotland, but government very much talks to health boards. And I mean, I will talk about Highland because I've spent a lot of time there, but live in and worked in Argyll and Bute. And basically the pathways of care and the consult. So that when you talk about the multidisciplinary team, that multidisciplinary team is in Glasgow. And, you know, as Dawn said, teams, etc., make that very possible to have those discussions and bring around. But there's a real disadvantage to Argyll and Bute because they're the north and in Highland, there is much more resource and investment there in structures. And Argyll and Bute sits very much often as a poor relation in that. While there's a lot of amazing innovation goes on, there are real challenges within that space and that disconnect sometimes between the... I mean, when you talk about multidisciplinary teams in maternity services, the way that the working is with children and families and maternity working hand in hand is exemplary. It's what we want around families. But, you know, that is very invisible in many ways. So there are real challenges when directives come out to health boards directly from Scottish Government, basically. But it's very much in an integrated space like Argyll and Bute and probably like Shetland. That is exactly where the daily work is going on. But it can be very difficult because the policies don't always match up.
Thank you. And Jackie Lambert, you mentioned there that midwives are very much part of the multidisciplinary teams within Argyll and Bute. Could you give a flavour of what that means for patients, for women who are pregnant?
Well, in terms of a multidisciplinary team, it's very much the team with children and families. So it's and some of those challenges around, we talked about parental health earlier, is that some of the very short-termism in terms of, say, for example, perinatal mental health, the time it takes to recruit and train somebody into a role, and often the funding is around one specific person, which is not a sustainable model. It's almost, as Dawn talked about, a generalist model is required to upskill so that you're not dependent on one individual, because that is a fragile, non-sustainable way of providing a service. But often those central belt, this is how we need to... So, for example, perinatal mental health is a really good example. The 3 years funding ended before the regional roles were developed. So those regional roles would have provided the infrastructure to support the remote and rural boards that would never have the capacity for the all singing, all dancing services. So there's often they get left behind because you will not easily and quickly recruit people to very specialist roles. You have to grow your own and you have to take different approaches. So the multidisciplinary team around families in Argyll and Bute is perinatal mental health. It is social work. It's working with that team very much and health visiting around the family, and it's a good model, but again it sits quite isolated in terms of how that structure is because it sits within an IGB, and that can often create a bit of challenge when you're trying to implement things that are directed through a health board.
Thank you, that's helpful. I wonder if I could ask other panel members as well what solutions we should be considering to address the challenges of the scarcity of specialist staff, increased home visits we'd heard about in previous panels as well, and long travelling distances for staff members. Michael's catching my eye. So.
I think the two obvious opportunities we have, and as the Chief Exec Scottish Ambulance Service, you know, we can deploy paramedics to take on things such as home visits, which releases the traditional primary care workforce, to focus on potentially the more acute patients that are coming through the door. And secondly, the use of technology. It was referenced earlier on. We've transformed very quickly during COVID to offering near me appointments. Some of that started to slip back, and actually for patients that are in remote and rural locations that need to travel significant distances for often what is a traditional short 15-20 minute appointment, that can take up a whole day, if not longer, if you're travelling from Shetland. So letting something go, that traditional way of working, is where we can make better use. We would all acknowledge it's better to be in the room with a patient, and often when you're delivering difficult and bad news. But again, working in a different way, maybe using having the patient travel to the local hospital where there's somebody who can support them during that conversation. But it's not the normal way of working.
And is that where way of working happening anywhere?
So yes, there are some really good examples, and I would of course reference both Orkney and Shetland have very close working relationships with NHS Grampian. We've got strong patient pathways for critical care, for maternity, for a number of other specialities. But there is still, are we always thinking where people are travelling and it isn't just an island setting? You know, people travelling long distance. Does this appointment need to happen face to face?
OK, thank you. Can I bring in other panel members? Nicola Gordon, yeah.
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah, great, thank you. I think one of the things we've heard today is about the broad range of skills that are required in remote and rural areas. So speaking on behalf of the nursing profession, what we hear from our members is that on a single medical ward, the work can cover the range of services from cardiac to COVID to paediatrics. So their MDT model is really very much embedded just in the nature of the way that working needs to be. We think there are some opportunities to look at development of the advanced nurse practitioner role. So AMPs play a key role in delivering high quality services in and out of hours in remote and rural areas. Clinical decisions are taken closer to home and when patients need it. And we find that increasingly AMPs are being deployed to improve access to care in remote and rural settings. We do think that things like this could be at the heart of the long-term strategies that are coming through. So looking at ways to sort of expand and think creatively about those MDTs. And again, as I've mentioned earlier, ensuring that nurses have the time and are funded and supported to undergo the significant amount of training that's required to become an advanced nurse practitioner is really important. Some of these education and development aspects are being picked up through the task force. We, if you were aware already, it's got a number of components: well-being, attraction and retention, education and development, and culture and leadership. So they're all interlinked. And an element of that is a listening exercise. We want to hear what nurses and midwives are telling that they want us for the future, specifically for their own professions, but also within their MDT approach. Thanks.
Thank you. Jackie, I think, wants to come in too on this.
Yeah, and you were asking whether or not there already was innovation happening there. And for example, if you're a midwife working in remote and rural and you're looking after a baby that's requiring resuscitation, we have neonatal teams that will be there with you in the room virtually and supporting you with providing that care. And it's a model that's worked really well for quite a long time, but they are streaks ahead in many ways of many others in providing that. That ability we've been doing for years of being able to be in the woman's home beside her while she attends a consultant appointment, so that you have that blend of she's got somebody there with her advocate, but that appointment can still continue. So there is good, often the issue is connectivity, but when it works really, really well. Picking up on Nicola's point, we have a real need, and just talking to midwives, for a recognition of that advanced practice in midwifery and a willingness to take on things to make sure that that care can be provided. But currently it doesn't exist there. And while Nicola talked about the task force, and I chair the education and development subgroup, my concern is we had the task force meeting last week, and the clearest message that comes across is there is no money. So that is very concerning in terms of making sure that we actually are able to take something tangible forward.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Jackie, do you have anything you wish to?
Jackie's absolutely right.
Sorry, Dawn. Yeah, Jackie.
It's about the funding. You know, we can make a wish list. And in the rural areas, Jackie was saying, in the acute ward, I could be nursing a paediatric, then I could be going to somebody with dementia, and then I could be going to somebody with palliative. And we do that. We do that on a daily basis within these small rural hospitals. That needs to be recognised. There needs to be recognition around that. Because if we don't, what happens is people go elsewhere and we can't retain the staff and keep them there. So absolutely, we need to be absolutely recognising the skills that are working out there for us in these remote and rural areas so that people feel valued in the job they do.
Thank you, that's helpful. Thank you. And I believe Tess White has a supplementary.
Yes, thank you, Convener. The question's for Jackie Lambert. Constituents in the North East have shared with me that there's a huge geographical disparity in the provision of specialist services, which means that many pregnant women and new mothers aren't getting the help they need. For example, how could perinatal mental health services be improved as part of antenatal and postnatal care in remote and rural areas? Thank you.
Thanks, Tess, for that question. I think I touched briefly on perinatal mental health services. There's a real requirement to make sure there's availability of education and development for the existing workforce, but that access to regional support, which again, using models like Near Me, etc., are really key. And that was an area that was still not fully developed from the perinatal mental health plan. So there's something about, we will never have every specialist service in every single area, and we have to be realistic within that, but there are ways to have access to. And so some of it's about opportunities for development, but also recognition that those models may be required to be different in terms of some of those generalist roles and taking on a broader remit, but there does still need to be access for the small number of times it's required for those specialist services. And there needs to be ways of providing that. And some of those specialist services, I mean, Tess, you're talking about, say, mother and baby units in three sites in Scotland. So that expertise needs to be cross-board because it isn't always available in every single health board. And that's still a gap.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tess. Move to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to panel members. Around workforce recruitment and retention, I know some of you have touched on the issues already. Jackie, could I come to you specifically, what particular challenges faced by nursing and midwifery staff working in remote and rural areas?
So the challenges can be that, for example, Western Isles, they had a student all the way through her training. And then instead of taking up a post, she was very much told by lecturers and colleagues that she should go and consolidate in a central area. That person has never come back. So there's a real risk in terms of people being, you know, almost tropes about you have to consolidate in a central belt, which actually isn't true. There's also the opportunities. You could recruit a maternity care assistant, a support worker, 100 times over often into maternity, and often they would have loved to be able to continue on to become a midwife, but there isn't access to that at the moment. And because it's a predominantly female profession, they can't leave their island or remote and rural area to go and access that education. And that's something we're very much pushing for within the task force, is there needs to be access. But as Dawn's also described, it's opportunities for development that retain people within that. I live in a remote and rural area. I'm talking to you this way, which has enabled me to do the job I do. Wouldn't have been open to me previously, but it's also about being able to be a lecturer, being able to be an educationalist, and recognising that you do not have to, that there needs to be these infrastructure roles are key to actually maintaining services, and they need to be recognised, valued, and a recognition that services are measured to the same standards. And if something goes wrong, they're measured to the same standards. So that you need to be able to have that resource to make sure those standards and that development and education can continue. And we need to make the most of the technology and abilities that we have to make that possible.
Thank you, Jackie. My next question, Michael, I'm conscious of time, so what are the additional challenges for ambulance and urgent care staff working in areas where long distances between services are a norm?
So what you're talking about is normal business for Scottish Ambulance Service. You know, the crews, and I've been fortunate enough to spend a lot of time with the crews during my first 6 months as chief executive, and they love the job. They acknowledge that driving long distances or travelling in helicopters, planes is normal for the role that comes with it. The biggest challenge that we have is that the routes we used to use for recruiting technicians to move into a paramedic role, so you'd have an opportunity to be able to step up through the workforce, gain promotion, gain greater skills, that all now runs through university. So we don't have a currently earn as you learn programme for technicians who aspire to become paramedics. And actually there's a kind of a conveyor belt. We have call handlers who do a really difficult job, taking those 999 calls, dispatching ambulances, who may aspire to become technicians. We can do the technician training, but they aspire to become paramedics. So we're working very closely with Scottish Government to get that tech to paramedic route re-established. At the minute, the primary pressure is hospital handover times, but I'm probably suggesting we don't go into that discussion during this session today. But the main thing is they genuinely love the job. And actually, for local paramedics, they have a skill set, which means they can leave people at home. They can and often do work really innovatively. They speak to consultants, they speak through to the emergency departments to try and keep, where possible, people at home rather than convey them to hospital.
Thank you.
I think Nicola Gordon wanted to come in briefly on your previous question.
Thanks very much. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Yeah, just coming back to that question, which was a good question around recruitment and retention and picking up on some of the points that have already been made. We are hearing from members that the additional responsibility in remote and rural roles is not necessarily or always recognised within the pay structures. So what we can find is within the NHS, a band 5 nurse can sometimes be the only registered nurse on shift, and she's doing that at a band 5 pay level, but taking on the responsibilities that you would normally have for more senior nurses, so covering the role that might be covered by a senior charge nurse or a band 7 nurse. So the pay structure doesn't reward that, and that can be a disincentive. You also know that our members in remote and rural areas love the work and it's where they want to be, but there's something there about finding a solution so that those career opportunities are there, and there's perhaps a different model that recognises the breadth of skills that are applied all the time. I think as well that question around attracting and retaining people, and I think this has also come up today, is that what our members tell us is that the perception of what work and life is like in a small island community, and in this case, this example I'm thinking of was Shetland, is it's different to the reality. Nursing in rural areas isn't quiet and slow-paced. It's just as stressful and hectic as elsewhere, and it can be more so. It's very busy. So there's something there around making sure that people are aware what those opportunities are, what it's like to live and work in a remote and rural community, but picking up what Michael said earlier, but absolutely attracting people and saying this is an excellent way of living. It's an unusual and it's a rewarding and it's a way of life that people absolutely love. But how do you get that balance right, and how do we provide opportunities for newly qualified nurses and make sure that the student placements are providing those opportunities as well? Thanks.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I attended a roundtable with student nurses a few months ago, and a number said that whilst they were keen to take up placements in remote and rural boards, they were simply not able to do so as they were not able to secure accommodation, and it was often too costly for them to move. Is that something that rings true with the panel? And how do we give students and qualified practitioners in a number of different disciplines the tools to fulfil positions that they might want to take up in remote boards? Perhaps I could start with Jackie Lambert.
Thanks, Paul. You're absolutely right about the challenge. Again, it's come back to the challenge about accommodation. And I've seen real innovation. I mean, in Argyll and Bute, we don't have any vacancies for midwives because we've offered opportunity. You know, we've been very innovative in offering, I'll say past tense, and providing opportunities for development and opportunities and also for students to be employed straight into remote and rural. There was often a misconception that you couldn't go and work in remote and rural unless you'd consolidated for a couple of years in a central belt area. We've proven that that's not the case, but accommodation is consistently a challenge, both for them when they're undertaking their student experience and placements, we've worked with local caravan sites and everything to try and get around some of these challenges. But for taking up posts, it's a challenge when people already have More experience and are earning more, but it's a real challenge at the beginning. And we don't have priority housing. We don't have any way that actually, so if you look at incentivising, being able to get a home in the area, one, makes you start feeling like you belong, but also opens the door to being able to recruit into these areas. It's the biggest challenge we have.
Perhaps Mr. Dixon, do you have a similar position in terms of paramedics?
Paramedics, it's slightly different, but it is comparable. Wherever you look in a remote and rural setting, accommodation is a primary challenge. Would recognise absolutely the key worker issue. So if we want people to live and work and stay into that local area, being able to find a house that they can buy, actually supply is critical. I do need to flag that there's also the HMRC component. So if people are doing rotational work away from the Central Belt and they're going to do a 3 or 6 month placement in a remote and rural location, their housing is considered a benefit in kind. I find that, quite frankly, bizarre that they would receive a tax bill for trying to help the people of Scotland. But that's genuinely the case for our junior doctors who come and have a placement into the health board. So it's a multifaceted problem, but absolutely spot on.
Thanks. And Nicola Gordon, do you have a perspective on this?
Yeah, thank you. Yes, I mean, in terms of the nursing student perspective, this is a particular challenge. You'll be aware that RCN Scotland surveyed students early this year. We had a really high response rate and we held a round table on that. We published our report, Nursing Student Finance, The True Cost of Becoming a Nurse. We found that nursing students across Scotland are facing significant financial pressures. It's partly linked to cost of living crisis, obviously. But we found that 66% or two-thirds had considered dropping out of their courses because of financial concerns. And 57% of those, it was due to the cost of placements. So getting placements, the accommodation, transport. It can be a particular challenge for remote and rural areas because the distances involved. And we do find sometimes there's quite late notice. So some students are telling us they get about a week or so's notice that they need to be going to one of the islands for their placement. So then it's a bit of a scramble, obviously, to get travel and accommodations sorted. We also know that... some of the students have actually pulled out of clinical placements because they aren't able to get accommodation. So I'd say of those challenges, accommodation is the one that's probably the most critical to try and do something about. That's come up a number of times today. And there's also things around clinical placement expenses, but we're making progress with Scottish Government to look at that, which is positive. Thanks.
So, Don McDonald, do your members feedback similar pressures in terms of remote and rural placements?
Yeah, absolutely. When I worked in the community, we had student nurses coming down and they ended up giving up their placement because they couldn't pay the accommodation or they couldn't get accommodation. Housing is a massive issue within the remote and rural areas. But actually, see where we do supply those houses, what we get in feedback from students are the rich knowledge and experience that they're getting in these areas that they wouldn't necessarily get in Glasgow or in Edinburgh and places like that. They are seeing a whole different skill set out there and they really value that.
You mentioned where that is provided. Is there particular examples where that's quite a good model that we could look at relative to other areas?
Well, I suppose what we did in Bute to keep the student nurses coming there, because we're a small island, 7,000 population, and we wanted to keep the students coming, is we spoke with some of the hoteliers. So in the winter, they're quiet. So we did a deal with the hoteliers that would bring the students in and give us a reasonable price for them staying there. I can't say the accommodation was always fantastic, but actually, I want to reiterate that when it did happen, they said that the absolute experience that they got was absolutely invaluable.
That's great. Does any other panellists have a view on pockets of good practice out there that we could hone in on? Has anyone got any suggestions for us to look at in terms of accommodation provision particularly, or any sort of particularly good practice in terms of in promoting student placements that work really well?
Jackie, do you want to come in here?
Yeah, thanks. Again, what we've seen is actually protected accommodation. So when there still is nurses' residences, actually protecting keeping a space that's always available for students. That's worked in some areas. And some of it has been to the point that, sounds ridiculous, but members of staff actually renting, you know, having rooms that they make available. I've seen that happen, which is maybe going a bit above and beyond. But part of it is the challenge of getting those arrangements with local B&Bs, local, you know, so that you know that those arrangements are in place. It is seasonal, though, and that can often be the challenge. But what I know in some of the hospitals that they do is that they put adverts to see if people would, you know, if their folk are available to make rooms available and things. So there has been some real innovation because people want these students. They want folk to come in and work in the area. But often it is about having local arrangements in place or protecting space. Often the challenge was that space was protected for medical but not for nursing or midwifery, and you had to really fight a corner for nursing and midwifery.
Okay, thanks very much. If there are any thoughts that spring to mind of places to look at, do let us know by correspondence. That'd be great. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. To what extent is the right data available to ensure that the right services and staff are in the right places and that we're adapting those staff to reflect the change in demographics, particularly with the ageing population that we have and the increased number of people who are retiring to remote and rural locations? Dawn is nodding, so I'm going to pick on you.
I don't think the data is... I think there is data. I don't know how good that data is, and I think that becomes an issue. So how do we provide that? And I think we need to look at how we do provide that, because geographically we know that the people come to our areas to retire. So we have got a lot of elderly people staying in that area. And the problem we have with that is that a lot of the younger community who we actually want to rely on for care at home, we can't recruit to. So I think, yeah, absolutely. I don't know how we do that, and I don't profess to be, but actually you're absolutely right. We need to be able to enhance and gather that data so that we can look at that and be able to reflect and act on that.
Don't know if anyone else wants to come in at all.
Jackie and Nicola are both indicating they want to answer you.
Hi, I think some of the challenges with the data is that things like SIMD quintile do not particularly reflect well the populations that you have in remote and rural, mm-hmm. because as we know, it's easier in the central belt to be able to define the SIMD quintile, but within remote and rural, it's that poverty sits right next door to somebody that is well off. So some of that data and reflection of the demographics is challenging. And also, while we know there are, you know, there is definitely a lot of retirees, a lot of people coming into an area, etc., it's, I keep coming back to this, you still require to provide services. If not, you're a self-fulfilling prophecy and people will not stay, young people will not stay in an area because there isn't opportunities for development and opportunities for schooling and for maternity services, etc. So there is a bit about how do we prevent what is happening and how do we go upstream rather than just watching something happen.
That's great, thanks.
Hi, thank you. Yeah, so our view at RCN is that the data used to inform workforce planning needs to improve. We know there's significant gaps in the data that needs to be addressed. That can be a particular challenge for social care and general practice nursing. We would find it helpful to have an accurate and transparent workforce baseline data set published ahead of the implementation of the Health and Care Staffing Act in April next year, so that improvement can be measured based on that and as part of the annual reporting. We'd also like to see workforce planning undertaken alongside and integrated with service planning. That service planning needs to be based on population need rather than financial considerations and constraints. And the commitment to creating and sustaining a skilled staff mix reflecting the needs of the community, all of this needs to be based on really robust data. So we do this, see there's some challenges around that. And in terms of the challenges facing remote and rural areas, the planning, budgeting, designing services, they're all really linked. So having that data set to underpin it is so important. I suppose our view is then looking at where there are the gaps and what can be done to address that as a key thing we'd want to see focused on. Thanks.
Michael.
I'll keep it brief. I actually think we have a vast amount of data in NHS Scotland. It's astonishing. What we don't necessarily do is translate that into really meaningful information. So good decisions are making. I think, just to put in context, whatever we have right now, it will take at least 3 years to adjust. So, you know, that is the training time it takes to get a practitioner to start their competency-based learning in terms of moving forward. I think what we do know is that we do have profound challenges in terms of nursing, in terms of medicine. I will speak for a Scottish Ambulance Service where we can continue to recruit paramedics without any significant difficulty. In fact, we could expand the paramedic workforce, and that would, particularly if they were used judiciously across the whole of the NHS of Scotland, really help to augment where we fundamentally do not have the supply coming in. And of course, the other factor is the universities and looking at the attrition rate, and that is variable across universities in Scotland. I think that's something that we as an organisation really need to hone down on.
In the interest of time, I'm going to do a really quick fire question here that I hope everybody will forgive me for putting them on the spot. We've spoken already about housing, about people often acting up a band or two in some cases. What would your one ask of workforce planning, one key thing to take on board in terms of workforce planning going forward that you think would really help within your own within your own disciplines, within the remote and rural area?
Pay. Absolutely.
I would say let's look at supply.
Okay. Jackie or Nicola?
Yeah, just to say sustainable long-term funding.
Yeah, it's about workforce planning that reflects, as Nicola said, population need and service provision, not caseload size. And again, that sustainability in terms of career options and progression.
That's great. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you. Ruth Maguire. Convener, I think I covered my questions. Did you have me coming back in? That's absolutely fine. Thank you. I'll move to Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much. We've talked a bit about innovation. I wanted to focus just very briefly on technology, digital technology and other technologies, and get a sense of where you think the role of the centre should focus there, what the barriers are to bringing in new technologies and what support is needed to ensure their successful implementation and rollout. So I don't know. Michael, do you want to go first on that?
So the first question is from the centre's perspective. Fundamentally, we still have independent health boards that are accountable to the local communities about delivery of service. And so, again, I personally feel that the centre has a role in bringing those together, particularly when we see workforce moving across, as they do, across organisational boundaries, demonstrating where good practice is and showing the opportunity of where that can be deployed effectively, rather than necessarily taking a leading role, because I worry then we start to duplicate other roles and responsibilities that currently exist. I think digital is transformational if used effectively. The duplication, the amount of times, and we say this, the work that we're doing between Scottish Ambulance Service and NHS 24 about stopping the patient needing to repeat their story to yet another person. Not even taking aside the distress that causes for the individual, the amount of time that we waste for practitioners, but also practitioners need to learn to trust the information that's being gathered by another healthcare practitioner. So I think the potential is there. I think we are on a really strong foundation with a single CHI number across NHS Scotland, which is massively powerful. But I think we're only at the beginning of what that potential could look like.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to comment on that?
Jackie.
Just that, yeah, technology is essential for taking forward services, but also so is the education, development, training to support it. It's not just about the hardware. It's making sure that so that you get the best quality of care and that people feel confident, both the people, you know, attending for care, but also the people providing care, so that there's clear standards of what to be expected and people have the right training and development and time for that to be able to make the best use of that technology.
Great. Dawn?
Yeah, I suppose there's a couple of things. Certainly for us, we struggle with technology when it comes to our catering and our hotel services. They don't always get access to computers. We're moving everything digital, and I think that's an absolute shocker when you've got people who can't access their pay. They can't access to go on to do their annual leave because they can't get access to a computer. And I think in this day and age, if we are going to move digitally, we need to think about these people. We need to put in that training that's there. But I think the bigger issue for me, being from a nurse's point of view, is care plans. We're still doing written care plans in people's houses. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that, but we had MIDAS and had to get it taken away because it was costing too much. But actually, people could... Social work could get in MIDAS and see what we had done. AHPs could get in, doctors could get in, you know, so everybody could get absolute access and wrap around that patient-centred care. But it had to be taken away because it was too expensive. So if we're going to talk about digital, then we need to make sure that we're going to fund it.
It was taken away because it was too expensive. Whose decision was that?
Local area managers.
Right, OK. That's very interesting. OK. I don't know, Nicola, did you want to come in on this this issue?
Thanks. Yeah, just a brief point. I think Michael made a really interesting point there about trust and organisational boundaries. And I think there's something here about remembering that digital solutions underpin the services that are delivered by people. So ultimately, health and social care is about people providing services to other people. So I think we need to remember that they're at both ends of the spectrum and the digital is an enabler for that to happen. So I think that's maybe something worth bearing in mind. And I'm conscious that through the proposals for the National Care Service, there was discussions around a single national health and social care record. So I don't know at what stage the work has been done. I know much of that's been done through co-design. So I don't know the extent to which that has progressed or has been looked at to ultimately have something that is accessible right across the spectrum of health and social care services. But obviously it's on the radar for Scottish Government, and presumably as those plans develop, we'll hear more about that as the bill progresses through its stages. Thanks.
Indeed. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you. Do the panel have any examples of where digital interventions have worked well to improve access to healthcare, either in remote areas or in any board across Scotland, that could be captured and scaled up to become a national standard? Just if anyone has any immediate insights. Thank you, Mr. Dixon.
So I apologise, I keep talking about Shetland. It is a really amazing place, if you know what I mean. So the lead consultant for diabetes worked closely to hold a portfolio of patients, particularly those that may be either deteriorating or considering going on to the pumps that monitor the patient's blood sugar levels. And so rather than saying that there's a divide between acute and primary care, which is an artificial divide anyway, what they did is they created a Teams channel so they could review patients with the GP surgery, with the community and district nurses, to make sure that the patients were continually monitored. It meant that the patients didn't need to go to the all the way, and I do mean all the way, to the Gilbert Bain Hospital, that there could be a local review, that the GP could work closely with the acute consultant to make sure if there was any deterioration, it could be picked up early and adjusted. And it's using that digital technology. It didn't need the patients necessarily to make that journey. It was about changing the way of working to try and empower the community teams that work with them more regularly. But to not lose sight, as there is also an expert that can provide them with help and support and reach back that way.
Thank you. Is there any other examples that any panellists would like to mention?
Jackie?
I think just ones that we've mentioned already, because things like Near Me meant that, and we counted the miles that was, you know, the carbon footprint that was saved. It was calculated because of people were not having to travel 2.5-3 hours down to Glasgow to see a consultant. Same for scanning services being provided locally, but with remote oversight of looking at those scans, you know, and also the way that the neonatal teams would be actually another pair of eyes when you were caring for an ill baby, where they were monitoring the car. They can move the cameras, they can look at the baby so that you can have your hands on and care for that baby. These things are happening now and they work really effectively. But again, it's about resource and a recognition that these require skills and training and, you know, the infrastructure to support it. Mm. So much of it is about getting the central belt to buy in. The willingness for innovation is there in remote and rural areas and often the ideas.
To turn to the central belt, speaking to GPs in Glasgow, they were highlighting that even if there are opportunities for technological improvement, they simply don't have the headspace to even think about how you would implement or deploy such technologies. Is that a similar constraint that you feel that the people, the staff you represent have, that they simply, there might be a capability out there, but they're so focused on the immediate clinical demands of provision that they aren't able to necessarily think about how to deploy that or do service improvement? What could be done to try and create that space to deploy new technologies?
Challenging. It's often easy just to kind of keep your head down and going with what you've done before, because actually change will mean stopping what you're currently doing, switching to a new system. It's exhausting, it's time consuming, and as you rightly said, you know, the belief is I just don't have the time to be able to do it. So the use of targeted project management resource, as we did in Shetland, as we have in Scottish Ambulance Service, can be really useful to come in and help people just lift their heads up for a moment. If the way people are, no one goes to work to do a bad job, and if you've always done it that way, then why would you consider stopping and changing to something else? So helping them through that change process, project management support can really help them in terms of, okay, I can see what's possible. I can see how I'm able to stop doing what I'm currently doing, let some stuff go, and actually focus on new and innovative ways.
Yeah, thank you. Certainly from listening to our members, is we're struggling to give basic care in the hospitals at the moment because of recruitment and retention. So, to, you know, and that's most important. For us, it's the bedside. We need to be there with the patients. So when we're struggling with the recruitment and retention of staff, you'll know that the wards are short, we can't get the staff to come in, we're using a lot of agency. Then to try and, you know, say to those staff who are nearly burnt out, here's something different. They can't get their heads into that space because they're too busy looking at the bedsides and looking after the patients.
Bit of a vicious cycle, you would say.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. Yeah. I just also wanted to pick up on the point that's been raised repeatedly about broadband being a physical constraint to accessing a lot of critical, you know, services and capabilities. Do you feel the NHS should do more to, for example, if there isn't a fixed line broadband connection into certain geographies, provide satellite broadband services to all staff so there is that assurance that they can have access to the basic infrastructure required to perhaps, you know, do consultations or access key services? Is that the sort of thing that might be worth considering or looking at? Perhaps have a perspective on that, Mr. Dixon.
We've found it, talk about Shetland, you're not going to be able, the NHS can't be the solution to literally everything. So we rely on mobile technology as well as broadband fixed link technology. Where we worked very closely with a particular community was working through the community hub. So helping them establish a suitable space where a consultation could take place in a community hub, rather than, again, expecting the patient to travel all the way down to the mainland hospital in Lerwick. And I think it's again, the risk is we try and see that solution for everything. Hopefully, with expansion of the rural mobile networks, the sharing that should take place, that should give us greater opportunities. But at its heart, and to reference the National Care Service single patient record, that we've got a long way to go before we end up in that space. And mobile technology is great, but it has to work in a way that's both offline and online, and then reconnect and roll the records up.
Okay, thanks.
I think both Jackie and Nicole want to come in.
Jackie, would you like to come in? Sorry.
Yeah, and I think while we can't rely, you know, I agree that the NHS isn't the answer to everything, but to move into an electronic way of working where every maternity record in Scotland is digital, but the midwives have real challenges because there's no Wi-Fi. So it's not just about the broadband connection, though. It's about having the... In small areas, you have very few people working in the NHS to actually do the IT, you know, so they are in very short supply. So there's also that sort of, like, infrastructure to support that IT infrastructure being developed, because you can't have, we've got electronic records, no paper option. Those electronic records are amazing. It means that the obstetrician in Glasgow can be looking at the same record as somebody on Isla is looking at, but you absolutely need to be able to connect so that you can, from offline to online, etc. And it's a real challenge. And it creates risk if we don't have that infrastructure. So we can't move electronic, we can't get it right without the proper training and the proper infrastructure. We saw it during COVID, and the Public Health Scotland undertook a large survey of both people receiving care and providing care in maternity care during COVID. And the biggest issue was about training and development. So being expected to move to new technology without the appropriate infrastructure and training to do that, which then often puts people off taking forward something that actually can be great. So you need that project management, you need that rollout of something in a way that's supported so that you can do remote monitoring, which works really well.
Thanks for that. Nicola Gordon, would you want to come in on this point as well?
To agree with what Jackie's just said there and pick up that the immediacy of the current workforce challenges do make it really difficult to be able to free up people's time to undertake the training that they need. So yes, the infrastructure and the broadband and the connectivity is important, but it's really about people being able to use those systems as well. I mean, we know that in the NHS alone, we've got around 5,500 nursing and midwifery vacancies. So the pressure is very much on providing frontline services. So the scope and the capacity to free up time for a number of the things we've discussed today really isn't there at present. So it's about dealing with those workforce challenges at the same time as trying to bring in some of these other solutions that would complement that. Okay. Thanks.
Thanks very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Tess White.
Thank you. And my question's for Michael Dixon. Michael, just to highlight one profound challenge we face right now, I'll give you an example. Over the weekend, as many as 17 ambulances were stationed outside Aberdeen Royal Infirmary's A&E department. And that serves, as you know, both rural Grampian as well as urban areas. So my question is, do you anticipate this will get worse over Christmas and New Year? And what are your thoughts for actions to ease the pressure on Scottish ambulance service both now and in the future?
Thank you. I'm profoundly concerned about the pictures, and obviously I'm aware of the challenges that have occurred in both Aberdeen Royal Infirmary and Dr. Gray's. So I don't think anyone is trying to belittle the situation. I think it is a profound challenge. Our bigger concern is that Aberdeenshire is a single location. There's no ability to be able to call across as you would do between Glasgow and Edinburgh. So my concern is also about the rural communities that surround Aberdeen, the wider Aberdeenshire. Fundamentally, we're working really closely with NHS Grampian in terms of looking at how we can increase the number of call before you convey. So this is about trying to stop people needing to be transported to either ARI or Dr. Gray's, to try and help people reach alternative models of care. And we have an excellent integrated clinical hub and a flow navigation centre, so we can try and get people to different locations. However, fundamentally, and this is a massive point of frustration for the crews that are caring for patients in the back of ambulances, they want to be out on the roads. I referenced this earlier. They want to be, picking up patients who are in dire need of help and care, and they're unable to do that because they're parked for often hours outside an accident and emergency department. Providing the best care, and I've been out with them, I've spent hours in the back of an ambulance caring for patients, and I've seen the exemplary care that they provide. But fundamentally, we are, even with additional support of the hospital liaison officer, who is our member of staff working closely with the accident emergency, we are dependent on that flow through. I think we've got to recognise that there still exists a profound number of delayed discharges across the whole of the NHS in Scotland. We have to recognise that 1,800 patients are currently sat in what is considered the wrong beds for their care needs. But the fact is, it's about the flow through the system. And we're working, all I can say is we're working incredibly closely. I don't think it's going to suddenly, miraculously transform, and we won't have any waits. We expect that there will always be demand on our service, so there will be delays, and we see that across Scotland. But the profound challenge we're seeing at NHS Grampian is of significant concern to myself and to the rest of the board and each and every single crew member who's working really hard across the Aberdeenshire area.
A supplementary.
Thank you. Just a quick question about outside of current issues. Does the Scottish Ambulance Service have enough capacity to deal with remote and rural? So it's not just emergency transfers, there's also patient transfer to appointments as well. So is there something, I mean, what would you respond to that? Is there enough capacity?
So over the past 3 years, we've significantly increased our ability to be able to respond through a programme called Demand and Capacity, and I'm happy to share some information about how that's increased the number of paramedics and techs that we have across the whole of Scotland. That's rebased in a number of particularly remote and rural areas, our provision to make sure we've got more extended provision in some centres, moving it from what was previously 12 hours into 24 hours. I think we're faced with two challenges. One is that we could continue to expand the Scottish Ambulance Service, and all we do is create more vehicles that will end up being parked outside the front of an accident emergency right now. We need to shift that from a system point of view. We need to see a greater focus on the back door and a flow through our acute hospitals to enable that transfer. We did that demand and capacity modelling on a much shorter hospital turnaround time. So the benefit we're realising, what's significant, and that expansion has been huge, has been limited simply because our hospital handover times has been greater than we modelled, significantly greater in a number of areas. So I think we're in a much better place than we were previously. However, the big focus has to be about making sure that we help patients get to the right place. The principle of no wrong door, be that through NHS 23 or be that through the 999 system. And people often do dial the wrong number, and that's not their fault. It's a stressful situation if your relative is unwell. So we need to help them to get to the right place using flow navigation centres, our integrated clinical hub. Even down to yesterday, I was up in Inverness seeing the mental health. Sorry.
We've already ran over time. I'm going to move to Ruth Maguire for our final theme.
Thank you, Convener, and forgive my mind blank earlier. I did have another question. I want to ask about palliative care, and I suppose this will probably be for Dawn McDonald and Nicola Gordon, just to ask what planning is happening or should be happening around that. Changing demographic in our rural areas. We spoke earlier about how communities were older. I've previously asked witnesses about the choice for individuals in terms of where they will be and be cared for. Do you have any thoughts on that, Dawn?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So for me, we struggle with Marie Curie in the remote and rural areas. So we provided the palliative care. We did a pilot to look at bringing community nurses onto night shift, because we don't want anybody. If people want to be at home and they want to die at home, absolutely, that's their choice and we should be able to provide that. But we shouldn't be leaving them at night and they're dying through the night with nobody with them. That's just, for me, unethical, and we shouldn't be doing that. So we piloted that, and I think it was a good pilot, but it was stopped because of finances. So I think what we need to do is we need to look at, if we are saying to people, you have a choice to die at home, or you have a choice to die in the hospital, then we need the resources and the tools to enable that to happen with dignity and respect.
Yeah, I'm aware of time, but you spoke about a pilot there. There seems to be a bit of a theme in terms of pilots or projects, which actually should be about core services, but they're treated as an extra. How do we get around that? What's the...
We need to stop the language that's used is test of change. It's not a test of change. What we need to do is we need to get around the table, and absolutely, as my colleague said, we need to get an understanding of what our communities need. What are the services they require? But more importantly, we need the funding for that. So we can consultate and we can speak with all our community and we can promise, you know, this is what you all want. But if we don't have the funding from the government to provide that and the resources, then there is no point to that.
Thank you. Would Nicola Gordon like to come in on that palliative care question?
Yeah, hi Ruth. Just very briefly, I'm also conscious of time. I think one of the things that we've touched on during today's session is about the breadth of skills that that nurses demonstrate daily in terms of their roles. So I was speaking with a member recently, and one of the examples that she was giving was actually around neurological deterioration. That was a good example of providing that palliative and end of life care, along with providing a range of other services. But one of the observations she picked up was the need for post-qualification education and training for nurses in remote and rural settings who are expected to provide that breadth of care. And she said that neurodeterioration is really important because it can be very small changes. So I think that's something we'd like to look at. We're aware that obviously there's a bill will be introduced in the spring around assisted dying, and within that wider conversation about palliative and end-of-life care, that is something that we are starting to look at within RCN. So we'll be picking up some more work on this next year. And that's something that we would obviously have more to say on in the future, but it's something that we're really interested in looking more closely at.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, conveners. A quick question for Jackie about remote and rural midwifery practice. NHS Dumfries and Galloway stopped allowing babies to be delivered at Galloway Community Hospital in 2018, so now women have to go 72 miles and babies are being born at the side of the road. So that might be even something for Michael to pick up. I know there's challenges around education, competency, skills, recruitment and safety. Obviously, it's a huge issue. So I'd be interested to hear from Jackie just a comments about the necessary requirements for skills development and safety when it comes to delivering babies.
So if you're working in remote and rural areas, and I know where you're talking about, it's about recognising the skills that are required and also remunerating and offering that development so that you are very isolated in your practice. It's wonderful to work in remote and rural practice because you do use all your skills, but there is no recognition of that. So if you're trying to create a model without any consultant midwife, any advanced practice, expecting everybody to do the same job and to be on call, I'm at a much higher level than many people would find acceptable, you're going to have a challenge recruiting to it. So it's absolutely right that people should be able to be born in communities, but it's absolutely right that people should be paid appropriately, their roles recognised, and have enough of a workforce so you're not putting a burden of on-call that is not sustainable on a predominantly female workforce with children, families, etc., that they end up leaving the services or going into other jobs like health visitor, family nurse partnership, because they cannot sustain being able to provide it. So I do worry about the discussion around babies born at the roadside, because mothers are transferred across Scotland from all different areas, and I'm really concerned that we don't introduce fear into the fact that we have wonderful ambulance services and we have wonderful services that make it very safe for people to be transferred, because it's not suitable for all women to give birth in remote and rural areas. So I'm always very concerned about the narrative, because what I don't want is for any woman to feel scared when she is requiring to be transferred for appropriate care. Mm-hmm.
And Paul Sween.
Thanks very much, convener. The panels may be familiar with the work of Glasgow University and Marie Curie doing a project called Dying in the Margins, which highlighted the reality of people who are terminally ill dying at home, and particularly in poverty, with poor adaptations to the housing situation. What is your own experience of how end-of-life needs and wishes are addressed in rural settings, and are there particular challenges in supporting people to have the death that they want, that we may not see as much in urban areas, because they don't have that autonomy of decision making about staying at home in the final stages of their life? Has anyone got a particular view? Ms. McDonald, yeah.
Okay, so absolutely, we will. If somebody has stated to us that they want to die at home, we will do everything we can do to make that happen. So we've got the green cross that goes outside the doors of the ambulance, know that this person wants to not be resourced, they've got all their stuff in there and whatever else. But actually, it's about that
caring service. So it's not just about the NHS, it's about social care as well, because they need people there, because we don't have Marie Curie or we can't get Marie Curie. So it's how do we support that in the community for somebody to be there? As I said to Ruth, nobody wants anybody to die on their own, but how do we fund that? How do we train people up? And how can we take the social the care services we've got in the community to support that?
Much. Is there any other perspectives on the episode?
Just to say, Scottish Ambulance Service have a partnership with Macmillan in terms of supporting people to die in the location that they prefer to. I'll happily share some information afterwards if that would be useful about that work.
Okay. How do you feel that potentially social housing providers, are they cooperative in terms of making adaptations to people's houses? Is that something you have experience of, how people's homes in rural settings can be made and adapted to support people to stay at home rather than going to a hospice or acute hospital?
Absolutely. So in rural communities, we the OTs will come in, do assessments, physio come in and do assessments, we work in multidisciplinary ways, and it seems to be that housing are, you know, happy to do that, to help, you know, people to stay within their homes and adapt the areas like bathrooms and whatever that are required for those people to stay at home.
That's helpful, thank you.
Jackie Lambert.
Oh, sorry, Jackie.
I think this is where issues go wider, because I know that, you know, where I live, it's very, very difficult to provide that level of care, because people could be living 5 miles up a glen, they could be, and there's something about that, again, going to that wider social determinants and looking at when community hospitals are built, that there actually needs to be a sheltered housing and housing built around, so that actually the limited care provision we have can access people, so that they're moving into housing sometimes nearer where facilities are available to provided when they choose to, rather than at a time when they are in distress. And part of the challenge is that we have a limited workforce in the community, and, you know, huge distances, and some of that town planning perspective, which is not for us to solve, would make a big difference in the long term, be able to provide that care at home.
Thanks very much. Thank you for that. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Can I thank the witnesses for their attendance today? At our meeting next week, we'll be continuing our inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas with a further panel of witnesses, as well as taking evidence from the Chief Executive of the Scottish Football Association. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.